We'll call the Appropriation and Education Joint Committee to order. And I want to welcome Chancellor Greenstein to this quarterly update, the first of many quarterly updates on our state system. With that, I'll turn it over to our Education Chairman, the Republican Education Chairman, Kurt Sunny.
Thank you, Chairman Saylor, and good morning. Chancellor Greenstein, it's good to see you.
Good to see you.
Of course, this is the first of many meetings to come.
Hundreds.
I believe we have quarterly updates, and so, you know, looking forward to hearing the progress that's been made so far, and get a good sense of direction of where the state system is headed, and when do we think that, you know, we will be financially stable. I really don't have anything else other than that to say.
Okay.
Chairman?
I want to recognize, one second. I recognize any of you want to go to your, recognize your members, have them introduce themselves.
Okay.
And then we'll go to the side.
Okay.
With that, I'll recognize the Democratic Chairman of the Appropriations Committee, Matt Bradford.
Thank you, Chairman Saylor. Good to see you, Chancellor. I realize you have a very difficult job ahead and appreciate the update. Chairman Saylor, I also just wanted again apologize. I'm going to have to duck out in a couple minutes, but I know Representative Schweier is going to help us out in that regard, so I want to thank Pete as well for that. With that, you also asked me to have us introduce our Democratic members. Just for the record, I'm Matt Bradford, State Rep from Montgomery County.
Peter Schweier, State Rep from Lehigh County, City of Allentown.
Good morning, Patty Kim, 103rd District.
Leanne Kruger, Delaware County.
Jerry Mullery, Luzerne County.
Mary Isaacson, Philadelphia County.
And everybody? Okay. Again, I'm Representative Stan Saylor, Chairman of the House Appropriations Committee.
Okay.
Representative Kurt Sunny, House Education Chairman, 4th Legislative District.
Yeah, you all.
Good morning. Good morning. It's Jim Robach. I'm right on one.
Yes, you are.
Okay. We hear you, Mr. Chairman.
Oh, you hear me? Okay, very good.
I want you to say a few words. Say thank you for having this meeting.
Chairman Robach, we can't hear you. Do you have an opening comment?
Might be on mute.
Chairman, if you can hear me, you're on mute. Need to unmute yourself.
Telling me.
I was going to go to this side and do all of them on there, but. Chairman, we can't hear you. Can you unmute yourself? I think there you go.
There you go.
It says mute.
No, they muted you.
They muted me, yeah.
We can hear you now.
Oh.
Okay, well, Kurt, John?
Representative John Lawrence from Chester and Lancaster counties.
Representative George Dunbar, Westmoreland County.
Jesse Topper, 78th District, Bedford, Fulton, and Franklin counties.
Marsha Hahn, 138th District, Northampton County.
Representative Mark Gillen, Berks, and Lancaster counties.
Representative Jim Struzzi, Indiana County.
Representative Barb Gleim, Cumberland County.
Good morning, Representative Lee James, Venango and Butler counties.
Very good. If we could have those that are on satellite coming in, if you would introduce yourselves as well as that you're here.
Just need to unmute themselves and...
Unmute themselves and then introduce themselves.
They can't hear. They're saying there's no audio coming into that.
They said they can't hear us.
I should. It's not the robot.
No, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Try it.
Can you hear me now, those that are on satellite?
Yeah, Jerry Knowles here. I can hear you.
Very good. Jerry, you want to introduce yourself in your county, and then we'll keep going. If people would unmute themselves and introduce themselves.
Representative Jerry Knowles, 124th District, representing portions of Burke, Schuylkill, and Carbon counties.
Representative Clint Owlett, I have the privilege of serving Tioga, part of Bradford, and part of Potter County, 68th Legislative District.
Good morning, friends. It's Representative Fritz, proudly representing Wayne and Susquehanna counties.
Good morning, Dave Hickernell, Lancaster and Dauphin counties.
Good morning, Representative Matt Gobler, 75th District, Elk and Clearfield counties.
Good morning, Representative Jason Ortiz, Allegheny and Washington counties.
Mike Jones, York County, 93rd District.
Good morning, Valerie Gaitas, 44th District, Allegheny County.
Good morning, State Representative Jared Solomon, Northeast Philadelphia, 202nd.
Mike Piscaric, representing Allegheny and Washington counties, 39th Legislative District.
Representative Reiner, Mike County.
Chairman Roebuck, I'm going to, if you're muted right now, when I'm done, when everybody's done introducing themselves, I'd like you to have any opening comments. But we couldn't hear you there earlier, so I apologize. If everybody else would finish introducing yourselves, and then we'll recognize Chairman Roebuck.
Representative Maria Donatucci, 185th District, Philadelphia and Delco.
Steve McCarter, representing 154th District, Eastern Montgomery County.
Ben Sanchez, also representing Montgomery County.
Representative Elizabeth Siebler, 184th, South Philadelphia.
Representing the 115th District, Monroe County.
Representative Megan Schroeder, representing the 29th District in Bucks County.
I believe that's everybody. Chairman Roebuck.
Cumberland County.
Oh, sorry, Greg.
No, that's okay. Representative Greg Rothman, Cumberland County.
Okay, Chairman Roebuck, if you would like to make any comments. You are muted right now. You need to unmute yourself. I apologize.
Unmute myself here.
There you go. You got it. We hear you.
You hear me? Good. Okay. Good morning. This is Representative Jim Roebuck, 188th Legislative District, Philadelphia. I look forward to this discussion about the state system of higher education. Although I am not a product of that system, I did, in fact, in part, get my education at the state system, both at Westchester and Cheney. So I did summer courses while I was in college. And I oftentimes point out that I did my course at Cheney was in state and local government, okay, which I spent the last 25 of my years of my life, the last actually 35 years of my life focused upon. So I feel a very close relationship to the state system and look forward to our discussion this morning as to what we can do to continue to support that system and provide educational opportunities for young people in Pennsylvania. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman Roebuck. And with that, I'll ask Chancellor Greenstein to begin his testimony, and we'll have questions after the presentation is done. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Chairman, and thanks, members, for this opportunity. I will be very brief because I realize there are a number of you, and you may have questions of me. So I just want to begin by thanking members of both committees for their support and the support of their colleagues for the state system, in particular for Act 50, and then honestly for the FY 2021 budget. I realize how difficult that must have been, given the fiscal challenges that the state continues to experience. So obviously we have just completed the first round of a long process looking at potential for integrating universities. We've completed the financial review. The results or the summary of it are in front of you. We look forward to discussing that and any other aspect of the work of the system. I just want to conclude my remarks by saying that while the financial review was largely a technocratic exercise, budget modeling in some ways, it really tapped into a sense of tremendous opportunity that we see, not just in stabilizing the system financially, but in expanding opportunities for all of Pennsylvania. And I think we keep our eyes on that prize, and that our future is a future of opportunity. And if we get that right, my guess is that the financial stabilization will follow. So thank you for your time and attention. I look forward to questions.
Representative Sonny.
Thank you, Chairman Saylor. So the process has begun. When the bill was moving through the process, it was often mentioned that the extraordinary powers that would be given to the Chancellor. And there was a shift in the power structure. And while your PowerPoint, shows us, what you're kind of doing financially, how has it been working with the changes in power since that has shifted?
Wow, that's a great question. funnily enough, from where I sit, I'm not necessarily experiencing a huge amount of power. The financial review was largely a technocratic exercise. It was conducted almost entirely at the Office of the Chancellor. It was about bringing together budget data that we routinely collect from our universities and building a model to evaluate them in the way that you've seen. The one aspect of the work that was really visionary was conducted at the university's level. This is intrinsically and must continue to be a consultative process. And so in the exercise of that authority, my response has been and will continue to be to tap into the universities, their constituencies, their councils of trustees, obviously their leadership, faculty, and staff in order to derive a sense of direction for the integrated universities. So I think with the enhanced authorities and with the enhanced powers, it is probably more important than ever to acknowledge and to pay close attention to the kind of history and culture of shared governance which exists across our system.
And we know that six will become two, so to speak. Six of the universities will become two. We know that six will become two. What's happening with the rest of the schools in the system?
Yeah, so a couple things. One of them is we're evaluating the potential for six to become two, so I don't want to get out in front of the process. There's a lot more to do. Across the system elsewhere, every university is involved in a number of activities. One of them is ensuring that they're aligning their expenditure to meet their new enrollment realities. And as part of doing that, working more closely together in order to affect greater opportunity for their students, but also greater cost efficiency. So you're seeing a whole range of shared services and shared programmings, which fall short of complete integration, but which are very closely coordinated collaborations.
So all are collaborating in some way,
yeah,
in some manner with other members of the system.
And with one another, and all are deeply engaged in the integration process, because if universities become integrated, there will be obligations for the other universities not integrating to support them in a variety of tangible ways.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Mullery.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Chancellor Greenstein. I want to talk a little bit about athletics. As the father of a student athlete at one of the six institutions being considered for integration, I can personally speak to the stress, anxiety, fear being experienced not only by the student athletes, but their families, as a result of this process. It hasn't been easy or enjoyable for any of those involved. My first question is, have you had any interaction with the NCAA, either giving them notice or receiving any feedback from them regarding the participation or continued participation of these institutions in the NCAA or the eligibility of the student athletes involved?
So I want to remind members that the process as defined in Act 50 is very deliberate and very staged. The current part of the process is simply a budget exercise. It is simply about taking multi-year budgets from different universities, looking at them, where are those universities, what's their trajectory going forward as is, and then integrating them using some modeling techniques and say what could be their financial trajectories. That the detailed process of planning, what will integrated universities look like, how will we get there, what will happen to things like sports, academic programming, student services, the library, all of that starts now, and runs through April. So, and this is a frustrating part of this process for me personally, and I know for others, that the real questions that people want to ask are questions like you've asked. And they're the most important questions to ask, to be perfectly honest. But we haven't begun, we start addressing them, frankly, today, after last week's board meeting.
Well, then let me just give a couple of primers on things that I think are very important for you to consider as those discussions progress. Not only do you need some type of acknowledgement, whether it's the form of guidance from the NCAA, I would encourage you to get the same from the PSAC, the Mid-Atlantic Conference, which sponsors four Division I wrestling programs in these six schools, and my daughter's conference, which is the A-10, which sponsors Division I field hockey program, because I think you need that in order to make qualified decisions. I also need to know if you are familiar with the Title IX lawsuit that has been brought in the United States District Court for the Middle District of Pennsylvania by female student athletes at Lock Haven University. Are you aware of that lawsuit?
I am not fully abreast of that topic.
Okay, well, you need to be because that has to be part of your decision-making process moving forward, because not only was the lawsuit filed, but there was a settlement agreement reached between Lock Haven University, the plaintiffs in the case, which were six female student athletes, and Attorney General Josh Shapiro. And that settlement agreement was approved by the court in the Middle District, so a federal order that is in place that outlines what needs to be done at that university moving forward to ensure compliance with the federal law. And I think you should at least reach out to, at the least, Attorney General Josh Shapiro to make certain that you have an understanding of what that agreement provides for and can make appropriate decisions so you don't find yourself in court yet again. Are you aware, other than the lawsuit that was filed on behalf of the Lock Haven student-athletes, if any of the athletes at any of the other five institutions currently being considered for integration have either current or pending lawsuits against the system or against their individual schools?
I'm not aware.
I would advise you to take a look at that in depth as well. Finally, you talked about this being a budgetary consideration. I know last week when you had your meeting, I was expecting a large volume of information to be provided, not simply a press release and a slideshow that we got today. Is it your intention moving forward that the next step will be what I think many of us expected to get last week, which is a more formalized plan, a more series of intentions so that we can digest that then? Is that your understanding?
So the process that we're following is the one that's explicitly defined in Act 50. It is statutorily required. The statute required that we conduct a financial review in advance of going through the detailed planning phase, which is the one phase that begins today, in effect.
And your understanding of Act 50, the next step, would that be what we all thought we were getting last week, a more detailed plan?
Correct. That is what Act 50 defines.
Okay. That's all I have. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Jesse Topper.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Chancellor. The work, obviously, that we have done over really a course of years is we've been asking for ways to find our financial footing with universities was done, much of the work was done before March. And of course, now we have this new set of challenging circumstances. So can you kind of walk through, depending on how long we have to continue to modify what we're doing at our current universities because of COVID and the reapplication of, I think, the COVID mitigation plan, you know, how much flexibility do you see moving forward, or movement will we see in some of these numbers? You know, as look, I mean, there's really, quite frankly, no end in sight. I mean, we don't have any kind of an idea of how long we're going to continue to operate under circumstances which are, you know, quite frankly, we're not even going to be able to see anything close to what we were hoping to see in terms of numbers.
So I can't predict the future. Only the pandemic can do that. But I can say, as I did in my State of the System address last January and to the appropriations hearings last February and March in both chambers, and I've said this to, I think, many of you in our conversations, this can has really financially been kicked down the road for years. The road ended. The road ended before the pandemic. The pandemic just makes the situation worse. You know, we're out of time, ladies and gentlemen. We just are. The state of public higher education in this Commonwealth is in some ways in our hands. And I've testified before about the importance of public higher education as a pathway not only to social mobility but to economic development, which guarantees the strength of the state. That's what we're talking about here.
And I appreciate the fact that, you know, for years we have asked for real dynamic change, and we're finally getting it. And I find that ironic that, of course, now that we're getting what we asked for, there certainly will be the pushback from certain stakeholder groups, and I understand that. However, that's important that we continue to move forward. That being said, I'm also looking at the effects that we're dealing with through this pandemic, and that at some point, do we come to the realization that we simply have to get these universities open in a way that students expect, that students are paying for, or are we really looking at possibly potentially a year or so, or are there any metrics as to getting these universities back up operating, whether it be with scholastics or any of the normal course of what we would consider college life?
So again, as you know, I think the authority to make those decisions is delegated to the presidents. They make those decisions in a way which is respectful of their local needs, circumstances, student bodies, and communities. They have made those decisions differently. I think on the whole, across the system, they have acted well, and the results, I think, demonstrate that. You know, again, like everybody else, we're waiting to see what the course of the pandemic will entail. I'm proud of our leadership for doing the right thing for their students and their communities and not necessarily simply following the money.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
For the purpose of an introduction, I want to recognize Representative John Lawrence. Lawrence?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the opportunity to introduce a guest that's joined the committee today. Jamal Clark is with us today. He's the president of the undergraduate student government at Lincoln University. So his visit today is very timely to stop by to hear a conversation about higher education in the Commonwealth. So he'll be joining us also later for session, and I appreciate the opportunity to introduce him to the committee. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Welcome. Welcome. With that, we'll move to Representative Isaacson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hi, how are you?
Good, thanks.
I just have a couple questions. The first one deals with the staff, with our potential redesign, and what are the considerations going to be when we're determining what we're doing with staff? Is it going to be on seniority basis, with diversity and women being the newest and least senior in the system? I worry about what's going to happen to the workforce. So if you could address that.
So in the process as defined, obviously we'll look to plan what the integrations look like and then determine how to accomplish those integrations. And that question would come up in that phase, how? Obviously, I'm as concerned as you, not only about the diversity considerations, but about the staffing considerations, generally speaking. We are bound by our collective bargaining agreements and would need to follow them. Where they have detrimental impacts on our diversity, we would have to open up those conversations with the collective bargaining units to see if we can address those impacts.
Well, I certainly hope you will do so, because we need to make sure that we continue diversifying so that staff looks like the population of students that go there. And then also with regard to this integration, and it's not just for the campuses, but they're expanding online according to your online learning, according to this presentation that was given to us. And in doing so, notwithstanding COVID, and we understand what's going on as somebody with a freshman in college, I understand the necessities right now, but we need to look further into the future. And I know, I see what you're proposing here, and I'm questioning, as the public universities that we are trying to support, and you are going to be asking for us more support of, you're supposed to be providing the college campus experience, the university experience.
Yeah.
I worry about the competition of your expansion going into other spaces of public education we support, such as community colleges. So could you address how you're not going to be competing with the different spaces you're supposed to be operating in as different offering of public education in the Commonwealth?
So, yeah, sure. So the size of the student market that's looking for traditional residentially based comprehensive education is shrinking. It has been for well over a decade across the country. We're shrinking with it. And so there's a public policy choice that confronts the members. We could simply just continue to shrink, or we could grow into areas which are currently underserved. Fully online degree and degree completion programs, 50,000 students leave the state every year for an out-of-state provider. Those are dollars that are being spent out of state, which could be spent here. There are adults looking to reskill and upskill who are underserved currently in public higher education. They have no public higher education option. And so, again, this is about growing. It's not about competing with sectors. It's about providing the needs of the people of this state and supporting the state in achieving its social mobility and workforce goals. That is our objective.
Okay, and I appreciate that, but I would say that we all have to be very mindful and careful about keeping the ability to have, because you have different price points, different sectors and different areas, the different opportunities that we have for public education. Yours is a specific sphere, and we need to make sure that we uphold all different ones. Thank you.
Representative Struzzi.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, Chancellor.
Good morning.
It's good to see you again.
And you.
I appreciate the information you shared with the PASSHE caucus a week or so ago, but I do have some concerns. I understand that difficult decisions are being made, have to be made. Last week, as you know, I represent Indiana County, home of Indiana University of Pennsylvania, mm-hmm. and I will add that it is one of the premier schools in the state system. And looking at the modeling for this integration, you have the Northeast Trio and you have the Western Trio. And again, I understand these decisions need to be made, and I appreciate that. Last week, IUP President Dr. Driscoll announced that they were combining a few colleges on campus, humanities, social sciences, and fine arts. There was also some proposed retrenchment of up to about 130 faculty members and other employees, and you would understand that that created sort of a concern with the local community, people losing their jobs. And again, I understand that this is an effort to right-size in many cases and position IUP and the state system for the future. But when we talk about the Western Trio and the Northeast Trio, how do you see those integrated schools impacting the enrollment at the standalone schools?
Well, I think that's actually that's a great question. That's kind of the modeling, some of the modeling we'll need to do over the next several months. The opportunities that those integrated schools are pursuing and sort of hinted at in the deck goes back to the previous question. They're really looking at underserved
right.
marketplaces. They're also looking at serving students who are interested in subjects which are low enrolled at individual universities, but potentially can be better enrolled looking across universities. If we do this right, we should all be able to grow. The market that we are currently in, and I can't emphasize this point enough, is shrinking. And the perversity here is that the demand for some form of post-secondary education is actually growing. So by staying in the market that we're focused on, we're underserving the state. We have got to break out of that. And the sector-by-sector approach, and I testified in this regard to the public, to the Higher Education Commission, to the Funding Commission, the sector-by-sector approach is profligating more higher education in the wrong places than the state needs in order to serve its economic development interests.
So long term, you think that the integrated schools will actually help boost enrollment across the entire system?
I believe that integrated schools will help the system diversify its offerings so it can better serve the so it as a system can better serve the needs of the state.
Okay, well, I think that's the right approach to take. I do, just so it's clear, I do have concerns, and I'm voicing the concerns of the local community that, you know, these integrated schools are going to draw enrollment away from the standalone schools, so yeah. Something to keep in mind. So,
yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
We have a question, I believe, from Representative Kmita, who I believe is online.
Yes. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, and good morning, Chancellor.
Good morning.
Thanks very much for being with us today. My question is this, going back to who is at the table in making decisions to this day so far and moving forward. So my question is in the category of transparency and process, including a multi-stakeholder input. It came to my attention that faculty and staff members heard about the integration measures via press release. And of course, we know about the signed contracts just last year and that the layoffs were not mentioned at that time. So I wonder if you could talk about transparency and the importance of transparency in these processes, and also how have stakeholders, faculty, presidents, students, staff been involved in the process to date, and how will you include stakeholders prior to the important decisions being made moving forward? Thank you.
Yeah. So the financial review, which was prescribed in Act 50, is a very technocratic modeling approach. It is basically taking budget numbers and putting them together into a model and looking at the various different trajectories that sort of are spit out of the model. And that was done at the Chancellor's office. We did engage directly with all key stakeholder groups, collective bargaining units, councils of trustees, presidents, et cetera. I know the narrative about people being taken by surprise, but I don't frankly understand it. The July board meeting anticipated a process where a review would take place. It's started by looking at three pairs of schools. The board anticipated a process where we would follow the data and let the data determine where we would land, and was specific in terms of saying we might end up landing with different combinations of schools and different approaches to integration. We shared that information as it was available. So I think that thing one, this process has been as transparent as it needed to be for a very technocratic and very centralized function. It was centralized simply because that's where the budget numbers are. As we move into the next phase, as you've seen in the materials that were circulated, we will devolve the leadership for planning what integrations look like and how to accomplish that to the university level. We've appointed leads in each sector. President Hanna will be the lead in the Northeast, and President Pearson will be the lead in the West, and they will build teams and ensure the consultation takes place in the way that you'd expect for a system of universities.
Representative, are you done? Representative Kmita.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. One caveat. Thank you, Chancellor. A question about shared services in particular, mm-hmm. and unintended consequences. My understanding is that Some of the universities have long-time relationships with local vendors and actually have, you know, can have good contracts and pricing and so on. And I just wanted to ask you, how will the shared services process be handled to make sure that the unintended consequence of sharing services and costs doesn't end up in elevating costs?
You know, that's a great question. So the shared services approach, the shared services themselves are managed by the presidents. The presidents, as an executive leadership group for the system, in effect, are the governing body for our shared services. Obviously, all of our shared services are, you know, put out to bid in the normal way. And so we will be able, as in advance of making a selection, to determine what the financial impacts, staffing impacts, et cetera, are. So I'm confident that the process is one that will is designed to at least give us visibility into the potential negative effects, and obviously hope and seek to avoid them.
Thank you, Mr. Chancellor, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
We'll recognize Representative Jerry Knowles, who is also online.
Thank you very much, Chairman and Chancellor. Thank you very much for the job that you are doing. My question is, it's a very simple question. So when we look at the schools that deal with the trades, when we look at Penn Tech and when we look at Thaddeus Stevens, we have schools that are graduating young people that with the associate degrees that are going into the workforce making $50,000-$60,000 a year. And the demand, Thaddeus Stevens graduates, out of the people Thaddeus Stevens graduates, 97% of those kids go to work on Monday. So my question to you, Chancellor, is, has any thought or consideration been given to shifting the goal of some of these universities at focusing on getting more welders and plumbers and electricians? That is my question, sir.
No, that's great. And obviously, Thaddeus Stevens does tremendous work. I think some of their subject areas in particular are returning that kind of 97% employment rate, and that's fantastic. I mean, I said it, and you'll see it in the slide deck. I said it in my opening remarks. One of the things that so excites me about this process is it has tapped into a well of enthusiasm for expanding opportunities for students across the state of Pennsylvania, including opportunities for students who are currently underserved. The Northeast is particularly interested in looking at creating opportunities for adults looking to reskill and upskill in a very very challenging economy. This would mean it offering what we would call sub-baccalaureate credentials, so short course certificates that enable people to get that bump in the workforce that they need, and that they need particularly now in the years ahead as we struggle with the challenges created by this pandemic.
Thank you, Chancellor, and thank you, Chairman.
We will move to Representative Davis.
Thank you, Chancellor. Thank you for being here today. California University, while not located specifically in my district, has been an extremely valuable resource for particularly underserved kids in the Mon Valley who seek to further education and progress in terms of an economic status. So in terms of this integrated plan, I have a few questions, and they're not all together, but who would be making the decisions in an integrated entity? So like CalU would be integrated in with Clarion University in Edinburgh. Would the Edinburgh president be making decisions on behalf of CalU? Can you talk about how that you envision that being set up?
Yeah, I mean, organization, governance, leadership would all be subjects for detailed review in the next phase of the process. Again, this phase has been pretty technocratic. We have given some guidelines in a number of these areas. The board affirmed guidelines which assume a single leadership, which would mean a single president or CEO for the three universities, a single faculty, a single staff, a single signatory authority against contracts, a single accredited entity. But there are any number of different ways that one could structure leadership within that context, and that will be what we'll be looking at.
Okay. And did you envision like campus services would be consolidated across the three universities?
So, I think one would need to be more specific. An old mentor, a colleague and mentor of mine, you know, used to say in the context of system, do commonly what you can and customize where it counts, right? And I think that applies to, you know, what services are we talking about? Where we need those high-touch, you know, student-facing kinds of services, no, you can't really just pull those away and do them from some abstract place in the center of something. They have to be on the ground, and they have to face that student. But there are many transactional things that we can, in fact, extract from the local community, from the local service, and do that more cost effectively, frankly, with higher quality.
Okay. And I believe the next phase of your project starts in April, correct?
The next phase actually was supposed to start today, but it started last Thursday. I did get the weekend off, but not the last part of last week, which I'm disappointed by.
Okay. I, for me, it's a particular interest of how those decision-making processes are going to be made, and I think many of my colleagues that have universities would care about that process as well.
Yep.
And finally, my final point is California University, along with many of the other universities, have a greater impact than just the folks who work in the university, the faculty, the staff there. The broader community are significant stakeholders to making that a successful place. I know you have a public hearing process that's laid out under Act 50, but is there, do you have a process to engage the broader community in terms of what this impact would have in those communities, in those towns? I mean, there's certainly going to be an economic impact that many of these communities are going to face, because of less foot traffic, less staff.
So we continue to review the economic impacts. Look, the track that we're on, the path, the trajectory that we're on, the impacts will be horrific. We're trying to change that trajectory.
Mm-hmm.
So that integration is about ensuring that these universities continue to serve their communities in the new ways as well as in the historic ways they've been so successful in. Not acting is no longer an option for the state system in the current environment.
So I'm not suggesting that not acting, but what I'm saying to you is that there are broader stakeholders that quite frankly make the schools a success where they're at, and I think not to take their thoughts and considerations into account would be a mistake.
Correct. I agree with you. And we work closely with our Council of Trustees. I hope we'll work even more closely, because they often represent those communities, and we can dig deeper into those communities and find other pathways for consultation. So it's a great, great point.
All right. Thank you, Chancellor.
Chancellor, a couple questions from me. One, PPE, critical. How has it been in acquiring that? We have the farm show is filled to the rooftop with PPE, so I want to know if you guys have been able to acquire everything you need. If you go out to the farm show, you can't really even get in because of all the PPE that's stored there now.
Yeah, I have not heard. So presidents meet together twice a week for 2 hours at a time. That's a lot. We talk about a lot of things, but a lot of it is about COVID and how our responses to COVID are going. I have not heard any real complaints about PPE. We tend to hear more challenges around testing and contact tracing.
Okay. The other thing I have is recently I talked to several of your board members at different events and stuff. And the one thing, you know, I think that I'm concerned about as the integration and how it's working for community colleges. One of the complaints I heard from some of your board members and that of the different universities around the state is they don't feel that there's enough collaboration between the state system and the community colleges. They feel, you know, the community colleges recently signed a contract, whatever you want to call it, with Southern New Hampshire University. And the real concern they have is they believe that the system will work better if actually every community college funnels every student to the state system, which would help the state system with students and also help those students who are low income.
Yeah.
What is being done to do more of that? Since they actually went outside Pennsylvania to do it, And like I said, some of your board members have expressed to me the desire that something has to be done to be more cooperative. And I'm not saying you're not.
Yeah.
I'm just saying their perception is we're not doing enough to work with our community colleges.
Yeah, I must admit I was as stunned as you were by the contract with Southern New Hampshire, simply because it does add to the 50,000 students who go every year outside of state, and they take their dollars to out-of-state providers, many of which I think Southern New Hampshire, I think, operates with 17 or 20 faculty, and the rest are teachers or instructors of some. So I think there's some impacts, not just in terms of economic, but also in terms of the quality of education. We do have arrangements for community college articulation. Obviously, those can be, and I hope will be, strengthened. The Western integration is looking very aggressively, as you know, at adding to its portfolio of instructional programs to include fully online degree and degree completion programs, looking at those areas which are in particular demand for community college transfer students, hoping potentially to, you know, win back some of the dollars that the community colleges have directed out of state. There are other opportunities that are available to us. As I testified to the Higher Education Funding Commission, a public higher education in the state of Pennsylvania, in order to meet its goals, at least in my view, needs to line up around opportunities and pathways for students into high demand careers, not around sectors of historic value with significant boundaries between them.
Yeah, I think one of the things I had heard was the biggest problem is for the state universities not accepting credits from community colleges. And look, I understand if it's how to kick a soccer ball, you're not going to give credit for that. But I really think they're accredited colleges, and their classes and their credits should be accepted wholeheartedly at our state universities. I mean, there's probably some classes I could point out at PASSHE that are somewhat embarrassing at times, maybe, to some people, depending on your point of view.
Yeah.
We all have those kind of judgments, whether that class or this class is worthwhile teaching. But I do think that to build a stronger bond with our community college will help save our system.
Yeah.
Since I'm a product of IUP, I want to see the systems work. But more importantly, I want to get back to its original mission, which is helping those who are low-income families and middle-class families, because a lot of those families now are going off to private institutions. That doesn't mean they're bad. They're not. But they seem to offer more opportunities for people who are low-income and middle-class families. So that's my reason for stressing that.
Yep.
I think our system is great, and I'm very proud of what you guys are doing and moving forward. This is long overdue.
Yep.
So thank you for that. And with that, I will call on Representative Madden, who I believe is online.
Mute. Yes, I am. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you, Chancellor, for appearing today. So I'm hearing a couple of different things. I'm hearing about how we're losing our students to out-of-state universities. I'm also hearing how we may begin to start working on shorter degrees, or not degrees, but workforce programs to get older adults retrained, things that are typically done in community colleges or in career and technical schools. So my question is, why, keeping this in mind, why is the state system mandating campuses reach their 2010 faculty student ratios of approximately 21 students as opposed to 18, which is really where the SUNY school system is right now? So if we're looking at, and then my other question to you is, will this, if we have to reduce the number of faculty, which will undoubtedly cause massive layoffs throughout the state, will we be looking to replace them with adjuncts who typically get paid less? And do you think that replacing tenured professors who regularly publish and attend conferences and keep updated in their field, do you think our students are being served by having more adjuncts as opposed to tenured faculty in the classrooms?
So I think there's a lot of assumptions in there. So let me try to unpack a few of them. So one of them is, our universities, if you take out Westchester, which has grown, and Slippery Rock, which is stable, have lost 31% of their students over the last 10 years. And we have, in order to maintain the kind of expenditure rate that we, to operate at that previous size, we've continued to raise tuition and fees and room and board for our students to the point that we're no longer as affordable as we want to be or as we need to be or as the state needs us to be in order to offer a quality option. So we're, as we return to those operating levels, we're returning to what was and had been normal for about a decade, 5, 6, 7, 8 years. That is the normal rate, not the abnormal rate. And we're doing that because, at least in my view and my recommendation would be to the board, we cannot continue to heap the burden of our excessive costs onto our students. That is not fair. I'm not sure I understand the question about adjuncts. Our use of adjuncts is capped through our contract with ABSCUF in our collective bargaining agreement at 25%. It is significantly lower than the national average in our sector, is about 45%. So I think we treat our students very well with respect of the use of a tenure and tenure track faculty.
Okay, and thank you for that. And I have a follow-up. So when we look at tenure trend of enrollment, we see that it increased from 1999 to 2010 by about 19%, and then in the following decade it reduced by about the same, I believe.
Correct.
So why are we looking at 10-year rather than 20-year? Because it kind of evens out the curve if we look at it over 20 years, as most of the demographers reported. And then back to the question of the professor versus student ratio, how do you imagine that we, and as someone who taught at East Stroudsburg University before I was elected to the House, how do you see that we are serving our students well by adding more student per professor ratio than trying to keep that capped at about 18%?
So thank you for your service as an instructor at East Stroudsburg. I didn't know that. That's fantastic. I would love to look over a 20-year period, because if you go back 20 years, the state was funding the state system at a rate of about 55% of total expenditure on a total expenditure per student. Currently, it's at 27%. We've made up the difference by increasing the price to students, and we can't any longer do that. So in the current funding environment, we have only a very small number of choices. We either operate at a level where we can keep our costs and our revenues aligned, or we continue this financial decline. This is a public policy issue. This isn't really an operating issue. This is about choices that have been made in the General Assembly about funding levels. And what you're seeing is that those choices are reflected in our operating. That is where we are.
Okay, thank you so much.
Representative Heffley.
Thank you. Are you, come over there. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a quick question. Overall, in the last couple of years, you've been receiving about a 2% increase.
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay. So, and what have your costs risen?
Gosh, I can't do it over the last couple of years. I can do it over the last 10. Our costs are
annually about an estimate about what your costs are rising.
I can't get to that number off the top of my head. I apologize.
All right, just as we look at,
It will exceed the increase. Will exceed the increase.
And that's exactly why we're here today, why we're having this discussion.
Correct.
So just wanted to loop back on some of the, follow up on some of the community college questions earlier. One of the great opportunities we have here in the state is the community college system. So if a student goes to a state university and maybe they complete 1 year, and a lot of students do that, they get there 1 year, they just decide it isn't for them, they go back, and eventually they may go back to school through their community college. Is the state system set up that that those credits automatically follow the students, so when they go back to the community college, they get they can take all those credits with them to the community college?
So credit transfer, the way credit transfer works is that the receiving institution will determine whether or not to accept the credit. To the chairman's point, I've heard the narrative about credits not transferring into the state system. I actually dug into it. 93% or 95% of all credits do transfer. Community college transfer students, if they need to take a course or two more, it's no more than a course or two more, which is exceptionally better than the national average. So our transfer pathways from the community colleges to us, despite the narrative, is actually quite strong.
And what about the transfer back to the community college?
The transfer back to the community college, that the receiving college would determine whether or not the credit transfers, just as we determine whether or not the credit
transfers. And are there ongoing conversations between the state system and the community colleges to that?
There are indeed, yeah.
To resolve that, thank you. I think that's very important. You're looking at cost.
Yeah.
Obviously, in these tough economic times right now, due to these these shutdowns are just crazy. But a lot of folks just don't have that extra money, so a lot of students are going to choose that option. And we'll make sure they get credit for what they already spent. Also, if a student goes and does online courses through a community college, is there anything set up for the state system? So I know a student that did. With dual enrollment, high school to community college, and then dual enrollment, community college to the state system.
Yeah.
Awesome program.
Yeah.
I mean, I would recommend every parent look at it because the opportunities are there to save an incredible amount of money.
Yeah.
However, if a student does that, do they still have to pay all the extra fees, recreation fees and everything else to that university if they're not on campus?
It really depends on the circumstances. If they're just transferring out to take a course, the answer is no. If they continue to be a student at that campus paying, so it really depends on the circumstances.
But even if they're not on that campus, though?
It depends on the circumstances of the student.
All right, I think that's something we can look at. Obviously, at the end of the day, my biggest concern is, as we go through these changes, how do we make education more affordable? In my opinion, education is about getting the best quality, best price education for the students. It's not about creating more jobs for faculty.
Yeah.
They can go get a job anywhere. These students need the best price because their families simply cannot afford higher ed. And students coming out with hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of debt is not why the state system was set up. So thank you, and I look forward to working with you.
Thanks so much, sir.
Representative Krueger.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thanks for joining us here today. So in 2019, the state system negotiated a new contract with all of your unions, and my understanding is that many of them agreed to a pay freeze, and also there were hundreds of staff who took early retirements to help with financial constraints at that time. Now, you have noted that at a previous point in this Commonwealth history, the state provided a lot more funding to our higher education, and this legislature, in part, bears some of that responsibility. In looking at your plans, it appears that some of the benefits that you think can be realized through integration include increased retention and graduation rates for students. But at the same time, we're looking at potential staff cuts. And my experience in higher education is that the quality of education is largely due to the quality of the professors providing that education. So those two things appear to be in conflict to me. Can you speak to that, please?
Sure. I think the quality of the staff and faculty is absolutely critical in all of education. In our case, it's not the quality that's in question. It's the allocation of a scarce resource. Do we have the right stuff being thrown at the right people at the right time?
So this plan that you're presenting to us today, how will it impact existing collective bargaining agreements?
So I'm not sure I understand the question, but is that question with respect to the terms and conditions, the terms and conditions, salary benefits, or?
Salary benefits, number of employees, et cetera, everything covered through the existing collective bargaining agreements that you negotiated just last year.
So I think one of the parts of the planning process will be to look through, we have seven collective bargaining agreements, will be to look through each of the seven collective bargaining agreements and see whether there are aspects of integration which have an impact on the collective bargaining agreement. I don't know for a fact whether it would or wouldn't. I mean, I'll give you an example of something which seems to me to be obvious, but it's an example out of my head, which is, if we end up integrating universities, there is some questions about how seniority works. I don't know whether that's a bargaining issue. I don't know whether that's an issue in the contract, but things like that, as we begin to plan the implementation of an integration, we would have to look very carefully at each of our bargaining agreements and see are there impacts that we'd have to resolve.
And to follow up on Representative Kamita's question earlier, have these unions been at the table?
Have they? Absolutely. We meet with our unions at the statewide level, I think at least twice over the period. And then as we go into the next part of the process, we'll continue to work with statewide level with the unions, you know, inviting them to here's where we're going, here's where we've gotten to, here's where we are. But you'll also see a great deal more consultation happening at the university level, which is where the integration planning will be taking place from here on.
And when did those union leaders first see this integration plan?
When did they first see the integration plan?
So was it before or after members of the legislature?
I can't tell you that. I don't know. So we met with our union. Obviously, we met with our union as we set up the process, and we said, here, the unions, and we said, here's where we're going. And then we met with our union leaders last week sometime, saying, before the board met, and I'm sorry, but I look at the board as the kind of, no offense, please, but I look at the board as kind of the episodic things that define my life. So we certainly met with our union leaders before the board met and said, here's what we found as a consequence of the financial review. And that was last week. And then this is my first public testimony to a joint committee.
So as things move forward, I would encourage you to keep them at the table. They are incredibly important as stakeholders, and without quality education and instruction, none of this seems achievable to me. Thank you.
Thank you.
At that, we are joined by Mike Jones, who is Representative Mike Jones, who's on the internet. Mike, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chancellor, thank you very much for the good work. I support your efforts. I would encourage you to move, obviously, wisely, but as quickly and aggressively as you can. As you said, if we don't get ahead and make these decisions, they're going to be made for us. I'd also remind everybody, I don't think we're in the employment business. We are in the education business, and the students are the stakeholder we're most worried about here. But I have two different questions here. And the first one, if you'd like to take a pass, that's fine. I don't want to do anything that would sort of undermine your work with the board. But I am just curious about, I believe, and if you could confirm this, I believe the bill we passed, we had hoped it would only require a majority of the board. I think we had some kind of compromise where it was 2/3 of the board to do any major closures or consolidations. If you can confirm that that's where that ended up. And then is the board generally aligned here that something has to be done? So, you know, you could go through a lot of work here, but you first have to convince people that there is an issue and have that sense of urgency. So I guess I'm just curious, at a very high level, are they like-minded? Obviously, they're going to want to see the details. But if you don't first agree that there is a problem, you can spend a lot of effort coming up with a solution, but people first need to be convinced there's a problem. So I guess I'm just curious if there's a general, I'm sure there's a lot of, you know, disagreement on specifics, but is there a general alignment with the board? and, you know, you guys pretty much on the same page that something at least has to be done and something significant. And then second of all, on a totally different subject, you and I had had a discussion at Shippensburg University about a year or so ago, and we had a real nice tour up there. I'm curious. I know part of your efforts are to increase enrollment and keep students in school longer, but my concern is we already have extremely high dropout rates. I think it's 45-50% of college students. I'm not exactly sure what it is in PASSHE that never graduate. And I would argue we waste a lot of students' time and money by encouraging college when other pathways would be better for them, or maybe they need to wait a couple years. Where do you stand on trying to increase enrollment and retention without lowering the bar, either on academic rigor and pushing students through, and or encouraging more students to come who really who we may be doing a disservice to by giving them bad counsel for coming there in the first place, if that makes sense. I'm curious what delayed. It's been a year or so since we discussed that, those sort of recruiting and retention efforts, and I'm curious where that stands, along with my first question on just the general mindset of the board. Thank you.
Thank you. Act 50 does require 2/3 vote of the board to approve an integration plan. The board is aligned. The problems that the state system and several of its universities face are significant. Retention, you know, the good news is that we have actually already seen a little bit of an uptick over the last couple of years, I think, which reflects the great work that our universities have been doing. Student retention is not a new issue, and our universities have been doing great work to address it. We're beginning to see the hockey stick effect as numbers turn up. We're well below the retention rates, generally speaking, that we enjoyed back in 2010-11, even though we had a much higher student-faculty ratios. Our students were hanging around a lot longer, which was good. But we're on our way back, and that's important. You know, there is still a obviously a number of our students, it depends, varies by universities, but a good number still stop out. That's where some of this short course certificate and non-degree credentials are so important. Imagine, if you will, a student who attended a university for a year or even two, didn't complete their degrees, but actually managed to demonstrate mastery in a handful of competencies that are well defined, that earned them a certificate that they could then go into the labor market and do very well. Right? And again, I'm going to come back to this sort of sectoral, the way we think sectorally about education. If we fund a certain sector, community colleges, to do one thing, and a certain sector, you know, the vocational technology colleges, to do another, we miss the opportunity of ensuring that our students anywhere, no matter what sector, have access to a credential which will be of value to them when they, whenever they leave that sector and go back into the labor market.
Thank you. I appreciate it very much.
Thank you, sir.
Representative Dan Miller.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sir, just to follow up on, I think, Representative Davis's question. When he asked about stakeholders, you went to the trustees. And I'll be honest with you, I appreciate that. I got to believe you are talking to your trustees, but that can't be the extent of your plan here, right, in relation to stakeholder conversations?
So I think the representative was asking about context with the local community, and I referenced Council of Trustees in that context, that was a critical stakeholder group in order to reach into the broader community because they're often representatives of it. So it was very narrowly defined in that context, or at least my answer was.
Cool. Who else are you talking to?
Faculty, staff, Council of Trustees, presidents, the usual. And then I think to the gentleman's question earlier, as we begin to move into the detailed planning process, we're going to have to engage with the accreditors. We're going to have to engage with the PSAC and through PSAC, the NCAA. So, I mean, there's almost nobody that we will not be able to talk to.
So in relation to the communities themselves, to which these institutions have worked and partnered with for obviously quite some time, what is the plan directly for them, and when would that plan be initiated?
So we're just now moving in, starting today, into that into the second part of the process. So one of the first things we will do is set up the process. So we should know, and I should be able to come back in 2 or 3 weeks and say, here is how we are managing the process. Here are the multiple consultation paths.
All right.
With some degree of specificity.
Ballpark it for me. Is this a couple months down the road? Is this a 2022? Ballpark it, where you think this would be a conversation that you'd initiate?
In terms of what conversation?
With the communities,
right,
who your universities have and colleges have been part of there.
Yeah.
So when will you be talking and starting a conversation with those communities?
Oh, we will begin in this part of the planning process to reach out to the various stakeholder groups and engage them in specific and tangible ways.
So just so I get it, this is something then with those communities that will be coming in, I guess, in just a couple months?
Within the next month or so, will see what the consultation process looks like.
Sir, you also mentioned there was some discussion about the costs and some of the increases. You mentioned room and board. You mentioned tuition.
Yeah.
You obviously have had an increase in administrative salaries as well during that time, right? So the last budget that you submitted, I think one of the gentlemen had said that it was for a 2% increase. Do I have that right?
Our last budget, this year's budget was flat. The previous budget with, I think, a 3% increase. 2.5%. I apologize.
Okay. All right. Close enough. If I got it, you were saying, though, in the last 20 years, you've seen a sort of almost a 30% drop in the state funding into your system.
Right.
Okay. Obviously, I'm aware of some efforts here. It seems like, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong. I'm almost viewing this here is that when you say that you had to pass the cost on to your students, is that really the entire picture that you have? Is it you and your administration, your system had to pass on the cost? Or is it that the lack of state funding has at least sizably contributed to what has been passed on to your students?
The lack of state funding has sizably contributed to what we pass on to our students.
Okay. Is it then, could one, I guess I'm kind of viewing your plan here, which look, definitely some of the integration aspects, and integration is a broad term, it could mean 100 different things, I guess, yeah. I appreciate that. But there definitely are things technologically that could, you know, that of our interest in the sort of streamlining things that should always be done. That type of efficiency should be found. Again, not sure how broad that would be applied. But like, I guess when it comes down to it here, would you be making this plan if you had actually had just had the state funding?
Yeah, I mean, I think it would be, well, two things. One, I think it was Senator Hughes and I at the appropriations, the Senate Appropriations Committee, who basically did the math and worked out that if we were funded at the annual rate of about $600+ million a year, we would be fully funded in a way that would enable a lot of things to allow us to reduce our cost to students and to continue to operate at our current operating scale. I think he was right in that regard. I've done the math in other ways and come up with more or less the same number. I do think there are things that universities have to continue to do in order to ensure that they operate effectively, et cetera. So I see this as a partnership between the state and the state system, and obviously we have our part to do. Yep.
All right. So, but if the funding had been there, most likely you would at least be looking at a much more narrowly tailored plan of integration, let's say.
If the funding had been there, and this is highly speculative, if the state were to have funded the Pennsylvania state system at about the national average of expenditure per FTE, mm-hmm. we would be looking in system redesign at revitalizing our academic program and so that we could meet the changing needs of students and the changing needs of employers, et cetera. So that component of our work evolving so we continue to meet the needs of the state would still be going forward. The work on financial stabilization would look a lot different, yes.
Understood. I mean, and again, the first part of your, that should always be your part of your work. You're never not looking to be right. sure that your education is well tailored right. to the needs of the. It's interesting with it, sir, and I do appreciate your answer with that. But, you know, I feel like there is a question, right? So I get a little bit lost in this here, like a question mark, a variable that I'm uncertain of, because there are some parts of your presentation that talk about the demand, that talk about the demand that's there, but yet how it doesn't correlate into some of the numbers that I think. Perhaps all of us would like to see. So when you're having the demand, but yet struggling to grow certain parts of the program, there is a question. I guess that this seems to me, and I appreciate the information on the state funding, but it seems to me then like this is, you are sort of taking I don't want to say a leap of faith without sort of an analysis. Clearly you're working on it and have done it, but this is something that will either So without state funding increases, so let's assume that whole 30, roughly almost 30%, let's assume that's gone and that ain't coming back. Let's assume that's the case for this question. You're either assuming that this integration model that you're still developing will either solidify your program in a way that will allow stabilization and growth, or there has to be some calculation that in the integration program, there is a chance that you will never again be able to serve the amount of Pennsylvanians that you have in the past, and your scope may narrow because you are not able to grow again by the changes that you have in place. Is that not part of?
I think the former is true. I think the latter not so. Obviously, one wants to look at integration plans very carefully and pressure test them in all sorts of ways. You know, we already talked about unintended consequences financially. There are obviously unintended consequences for communities, for students, etc. And I hope we will pressure test them in those ways. Mm-hmm. I don't believe that integration will narrow a path to growth. I don't.
Would you rather be talking about that? Would you rather have this plan or your 28% of money that would take out the financial stabilization question?
So I think of myself as the CEO of this institution, of this great institution. I am, in effect, in employment by the board and the General Assembly. And I am dealing the hand that I have been dealt.
You're happy with your hand?
I'm here to serve.
Thank you.
Well, I will interject here. One of the problems and the reason we're here today is simply because this system has been mismanaged for so many years. 20 years, this organization has been mismanaged. We finally have a chancellor who's willing to address it and make the change that need to be made. This doesn't have anything to do with money, because the student population has gone down and the rate of inflation of our PASSHE system has gone far and above the rate of inflation. It is not serving the students of low-income families and middle-class families anymore. And if private institutions can do that, and our state system cannot, blaming it on money is not the issue here. It is the way our system was run for the last 20 years. So I give the chancellor a great deal of credit for the job he's doing. I actually told him when he was appointed, he has the toughest job, I believe, at any chancellor in our nation. And I congratulate him on the work he's done. This is not about money in the past. It's about mismanagement that has taken place in our system. As a product of IUP, I am proud to finally see this system moving forward in a direction that's responsible and not looking to the past. It needs to serve the people of Pennsylvania who are funding it. So with that, I will move to Representative Lawrence.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you, Chancellor, for being here today. I appreciate your work, and I appreciate the fact that you're willing to come before the General Assembly for a grilling. So thank you. I appreciate you being here today. Could you speak to me a little bit about, you know, with all these changes going on with the state system of higher education, the biggest stakeholders here are the students. So how are you involving them in the decisions that are being made and the conversations around, you know, consolidation? What conversations are you having with, you know, either student government leaders or, you know, focus groups of students, or, you know, these days via Zoom? What conversations are you having with them?
So again, I mean, in the financial review, narrow technical piece of work, so high level of engagement with student government presidents, the board of student government presidents, so it was at statewide level. As we move forward, the planning process will now shift from the chancellor's office into the regional, into the regions, and there will be direct consultation with students. I would add to that that I have had the pleasure, I visit our universities every year, every term, twice a year. I did this term by Zoom. I've done 12 of the 14. I always meet with students on these visits, and when we talk about integration, they're excited. And they're excited because they see expanded opportunity, right? They see expanded opportunity not just in the academic programming, but in the student life and the student supports and the ability to engage with others from other universities. You know, it's actually one of the most inspiring things I get to do is to see it through their eyes. You know, that's at a personal level, and we'll obviously be stepping to a more formal level as we go forward.
Very good. I appreciate that input, and Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the opportunity. Thank you.
Chancellor, I have to head off to another meeting. Again, I want to thank you for your time today. I'm going to turn it over to our education chairman, Kurt Sunny. Again, thank you for your testimony.
Thank you, Chairman.
Representative Patty Kim.
Good morning. Thank you, Chairman, and good morning, Chancellor. We have legislation to allow PASSHE to sell Dixon University in Harrisburg. How much savings do you project in this sale once the bill is passed?
So I'm told that the building could sell for between $4 and $6 million, but don't expect to sell it quickly. And obviously, if that happened, there's also a building reserve fund, you know, which we use in case the roof falls in, which would then no longer be necessary. Those are one-time, I mean, both would be one-time dollars.
Okay. Are you looking at any other properties, PASSHE-owned properties, to sell off in the near future?
So some of our universities are looking at sale of properties. I'm aware, for example, of the Perico, because the board just did an action giving Edinburgh the opportunity to sell the Perico campus if that opportunity emerged. There may be others that I'm just not calling to mind, but the only ones that the chancellor's office is responsible for is the Dixon Center.
Okay. I know we passed Act 50, and we need to discuss the outline now with very few details. And but when your personnel is 75% of the budget, we know that we have a good idea where things may go. I don't know if you're surprised, but I read your chancellor's blog.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. I know there are a lot of people reading that. You were talking about shifting faculty from maybe one department to another. Their faculty members are very talented, and that you could shift them. Can you expound on that? And if faculty members are listening now, how could they prepare for that change?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure we're talking about shifting faculty members from one department to another. We're obviously talking about pretty significant restructuring, reorganization. We saw that last week. It was already mentioned. President Driscoll, I think, came up with a very innovative plan for IUP, which looks at integrating schools. And other universities are doing the same, and going forward, I'll expect that to continue to happen. Obviously, you know, we value all of our faculty and our staff. They are, you know, critical to the mission. They're critical to our students. They have long years of dedicated service. They're talented people. You know, our student success relies not just on faculty, but on the staff that we have. They're our most precious gift. So, you know, obviously we've talked about consultation, we've talked about, you know, analytically trying to work through the various approaches that we'll be taking and understanding their consequences. I look forward to working together with all stakeholders, including faculty and staff, in addressing exactly those issues.
Also in your blog, I got a sense from you that, you know, we're at a pivotal moment in time and have the ability to change the trajectory of our state system schools. I believe that too. And we can call this plan a different name, like integration, but really we're just keeping PASSHE on life support and then putting the system in a hospice in 3 years, which I hope is not the case. Or we can make a real investment in these schools and take our universities to long-term sustainability and equip our kids for today's workforce. If we're talking about your students and giving them the affordable, high-quality education that we want for them, let's do it. You have a really difficult job, obviously, and I don't envy you, but what would be your wish list? And it's very convenient that the chairman left, because I disagree with him. Because you, in your answer with Representative Miller's, was if we had fully funded the PASSHE school system, we may be in a different place. We cannot say we want this for our students and give them the bare minimum and hope that'll work. We brought you in here because of our lack of responsibility. If you didn't have the parameters that you have right now, what would be your wish list, Chancellor?
So, Representative Kim, you're going to steer me into an unguarded moment. My staff are going to be horrified. But it's only because you are the representative from my district, and I appreciate your service. You're both right. You are both right, the chairman and yourself. This is a partnership. The public higher education is a partnership. It requires appropriate level of support from the state, and it requires the state system to manage itself effectively. Both of those things need to happen. In my view, we have a lot to do on our side, and I said that at the Appropriations Committee, and that was committees, and that was hearings, and that was in advance of the pandemic. The pandemic only accelerated the path that we're on. We have a great deal to do to become more responsive to the needs of the students of this state and to the needs of our employers and our communities. We cannot simply continue as we are, staring into the rearview mirror and executing against a strategy of hope. Our leadership, in my view, has been focused on the future for several years now. They're beginning to demonstrate results in terms of enrollment, in terms of retention, in terms of new programming, in terms of helping their students achieve viable pathways, you know, into sustaining careers and great community lives. And I'm proud of what we have accomplished. We have a great deal more to do. But, and this is my ask of you, it is going to require those two very different views, those almost polar opposite views, to come together and acknowledge the fact that both are correct. We will need support from this body to get ourselves through to the future that this Commonwealth needs. And we will need support from this body to enable us to engage in the very difficult and essential and necessary restructuring and refocusing. Neither of those things are sufficient to achieve our objectives by themselves. They are necessary but not sufficient conditions. We need you, I need you, to somehow find a path to integrating those two views and holding them together in your collective head so that we can do what is really a very difficult. We have this. I am convinced that the management of these institutions that we have what it takes to get this job done. But as we've heard today, there are any number of obstacles which can and probably will trip us up. And that is where we need your help together.
Appreciate your answer. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Representative Brown.
Thank you, Chancellor. Good morning.
Good morning.
I came in a little bit later this morning, so I hope that I didn't miss in some of your testimony. But as the questions have come up about the quality of education and the cost of education for our students across Pennsylvania, with the integration program, it's because we've dealt with COVID as well, and we've seen obviously the online education dramatically increasing because of the COVID crisis. With the integration model, with the COVID experience, I've spoken to many students, many families. You know, the online, some are okay with it and some feel the value of that is not the same value, obviously, as being in person. With the integration model and that knowledge base of what we've been through, what do you think the plans are further for the online piece of it, improving that, building on that, the opportunities that will make it different from what it is right now, what students are experiencing and what families feel is not really worth it? Yeah. Where do you see that going? And I think where do you see that going too as far as the cost? Yeah. An online course credit value versus a in-person cost value?
Yeah. So a couple of things, and I'm gonna speak for the industry and maybe find a way into the Pennsylvania state system. So interest in online and hybrid forms of education has been growing for well over a decade, at just south of 10% a year, I think, but I want to check that. Interest in the kind of residentially based comprehensive university that we offer, traditional stuff that we offer, has been declining again for over a decade. Those are sectoral trends. They represent consumer choice. They just do. And then we have choices as an institution about how we evolve to meet those demands. Obviously, we can continue to offer the traditional form of on-ground, residentially focused education that we do, and we'll just get smaller, and that's okay. That's a reasonable choice to make. It does mean that we will not be able to sustain, in my view, 14, you know, wholly independent universities. I think interestingly, so thing one. Thing two is that the kind of remote learning that has we've resorted to during the pandemic, and this is true again across higher education, it is remote, but it's not necessarily the best in online learning. You know, our universities, and this is true across the country, we moved in ways which nobody like me would ever have expected. I mean, we just turned the earth upside down and still made it work. And it was, you know, pretty remarkable. And our students have been resilient and great. And, you know, they have some pretty significant challenges in terms of engagement. We've also learned a thing or two. So my expectation is that going forward, the interest in remote and hybrid forms of education, which has already been growing for over a decade, will continue to grow probably an accelerated rate, not just in post-secondary, but also in secondary education. And we, as educators, need to prepare for and engage with that future, as opposed to looking in the rearview mirror and wishing that, gosh, it should have been this way old, you know, we should go back.
Right.
That's where our students are going.
Yeah, and I agree, and I think it's just something that's in the back of my head as far as the quality, the cost, and also from the professor's standpoint. What do you feel the feedback is from the professor's standpoint on utilizing that in more advanced ways as we move forward?
You know, I think, you know, we have seen the best of our faculty and the best of our students over the past several months in so many different ways. And again, these are choices that I think we're going to have to make. There are so many people who need us, who need some access to post-secondary education, who cannot or don't want to or can't afford to have all of the trappings of a residentially based program. There are those who do need that and want that, and that's great, and we should always be there for them. But as a public institution, we cannot simply deny the demand of the rest. They are still our Pennsylvanians. They need us now.
Thank you so much. I look forward to more on that as we move forward. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Representative Schreier.
Thank you, Chairman. I appreciate it. Chancellor, thank you for being here today. Thank you for the report. Thank you for engaging in this process. Thank you for engaging with my colleagues. I think, if I may, I want to kind of take a step back and look at this a little bit more from a broader perspective, because what I, unlike some of my, many of my colleagues here today, I don't have a PASSHE campus in Lehigh County. I have parts of a satellite campus affiliated with a branch campus of a community college in my district, right? But what it seems to me that I'm hearing from my colleagues and speaking with Chairman Bradford ahead of time, there seems to be sort of three or four really major areas of concern from our side of the aisle. Number one, how many academic programs or support services are going to be lost throughout this process? Which leads into the question of how many jobs are going to be lost that are both PASSHE employees, but also, as we learned today, its impact on the communities. How many of those small mom and pop vendors, how many of the restaurants, how many of the folks who've built their economy and their economic livelihood around the particular institution, how are they going to be impacted, and how are they going to be engaged in this process? Those are concerns of folks who have a large presence of PASSHE in their district. Again, I don't have that. What I have is sort of the third question, which is how are we going to be able to expand, protect and expand enrollment in PASSHE schools when we are talking about potentially cutting programs, reducing support staff, those sorts of things. We've talked about that a bunch. I've heard that from a number of our colleagues on both sides of the aisle. The fourth group of folks that we're not considering, however, are the potential future PASSHE students. We've talked about engaging current students in this. What does it look like for folks who are sophomores and juniors now if their senior year is going to be so vastly changed? Representative Mullery talked about student athletes and those sorts of things. In places like Allentown and Greater Lehigh Valley that don't have access, direct access to PASSHE schools, they're not a neighborhood school, I should say. They have certainly have direct access, but they're not a neighborhood school. Their decision on whether or not to go to Kutztown, Bloomsburg, East Stroudsburg, which are the three closest to the Greater Lehigh Valley, versus going to somewhere like Penn State is going to be directly tied to PASSHE's ability to deliver a product that they feel is meaningful, appropriate, at a reasonable cost. When we're hearing things like, earlier today we heard a question or heard a comment that six universities are going to become two. Begs the question for those parents, which four campuses are getting closed and when are they closing? Because that's what I heard. And if I'm a parent thinking about sending my kid to, say, Cal, why wouldn't I just choose Pitt or Pitt, a branch campus of Pitt or a branch campus of Penn State? So I guess my two overall questions are going to be, number one, do we have a decision on how many campuses are going to be closed? How many universities are going to be closed? And if the answer is no, you're not prepared to answer that. I already know because of the guardrails that you mentioned before, you're not going to answer that question. But that is really the question that is being asked in homes across the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Yeah. It's a question of how many in everywhere. And the other question is, how are we really truly going to compete? How is PASSHE really going to truly compete if this is what's going to happen?
Now, those are great. Let me try to take them in some order. So we're not closing anything. The authority to close a campus, a university, resides with this body, does not reside to the board. It was not distributed to the board as a consequence of Act 50. Act 50 specifically forbids closure. So that's not happening. The thrust of integration is to ensure that viable instructional activity continues at all of our universities and that we curtail the devastating economic impacts that would result if we are unable somehow to solve this problem. Mm-hmm. So I think that's the second thing. The third thing is, and again, I'll reference the students that I've had the honor, privilege of speaking with over the last couple of months, is this is about preserving programs, not eliminating them. Let me elaborate, and let me elaborate in the context of my favorite program, Celtic poetry. Pretty sure Celtic poetry is not something which is taught anywhere, so I can talk about it without anybody getting really panicked. It's a great subject area, and obviously what happens at a university is enrollments decline. They cannot afford to offer the full range of programs. And they find themselves in their Department of Celtic Poetry graduating a couple of students a year. And inevitably, at some point, those programs, because they're not any longer viable economically, become under some kind of question. By clubbing together, by working together, we can ensure that the best Celtic poetry program exists for any student anywhere in the state who wishes to take it from whatever university they attend. And that is true across the board. This is not about eliminating programs. This is about saving them. This is about saving programs across the full range of academic knowledge, which are critical to the future of our state. So in some ways, there has never been a better time to come to one of the Pennsylvania State System universities, because you can go with the confidence that the program I begin will not only continue, it will be continuing at some level of scale that wasn't already available. The opportunities through integration on the programmatic side are profoundly important.
I'm not going to certainly make any criticism of anybody who wants to study Celtic poetry, nor were you, Chancellor. But there is a question, going back to the closing, there is a question of closing versus closing, right? So we can we have seen, as a public policy perspective, this is not a PASSHE question per se, but legislatures across the United States, our own U.S. Congress, the courts, what they will do is there's a creep. There is a general eroding of something that is happening at any particular, in any particular public policy, whereas I won't get into any of the policies that are pretty obvious, because I don't want to turn this into a national political debate here. That's not what I'm talking about. But you can effectively impact or reduce the quality of a campus or a school by eliminating a whole bunch of programs, even if they are going regional, even if they're going to be, you know, taught from a student at Cal is going to be able to learn from a professor in Edinburgh. There's still the impact on Cal if we start reducing a whole bunch of those academic programs on site. In effect, you're not closing that campus, but what you're doing is, and not you, and I apologize, I'm not trying to make this you, but we as a collective, because this is all of us together, our ability to appropriate dollars for you and your ability to manage those appropriately, if we collectively start reducing the impact, the number of programs on a campus, whereas you might effectively not close it, we really are dramatically impacting it. You're reducing jobs in the community. You're impacting that local community. If you were to, for example, close, or because of our inability to fund it or some derivative thereof, if you were to reduce the number of academic programs in one particular campus, whereas that campus may actually be open, it will look dramatically different. We have to be honest about that. We have to be able to say if we are eliminating, for example, a sizable number of academic programs, even if those programs are smaller, we are in fact closing big parts of that campus. Is that a fair statement?
So I think we have a choice, all of us individually. We can go forward with a sense of fear and loathing or a sense of opportunity and growth. I prefer a sense of opportunity and growth. I encourage people to think about imagine if. And let me give you a couple of concrete examples of why I see opportunity and growth. We're looking at the schools in the Northeast, Bloom, Lock Haven, and Mansfield, of which Bloomsburg has an AACSB accredited business school, highest level of accreditation you can achieve for a business school.
Right.
All of a sudden, students Mansfield and Lock Haven have access to a program they could not possibly, and that Mansfield and Lock Haven could not reasonably expect to ever develop to achieve that level of accreditation. Possible, but pretty decent stretch. Let me go another example. Again, from the same group of three. Lock Haven has a strong program in physical assistance and has great relations with UPMC. Bloomsburg has good programs, great programs in health professions with great relations with Geisinger. Imagine the opportunity to bring those two together and to now serve the health professions of the region across a range of disciplines, working with the two of the several largest providers in the state, right? Another conversation on the West, I was talking to a faculty member who teaches, I think, mechatronics, which is a form of engineering. It is only available at that particular school. All of a sudden, potentially, that is now available to all the students at the universities in that triad. It's the sense of opportunity and enrollment growth is palpable. So I think I would look at it in terms of impact on the community. If we get this right, we are growing jobs. If we continue the way we are losing them.
My oldest daughter is 13 years old. She is taking her first college class as an eighth grader in a dual enrollment with our community college right now. She's on a college track. She is smarter than me, she's going to go have a lot of opportunities when she graduates from high school in 4.5 years. I would be very hard-pressed to tell her that if you go to Mansfield, you're going to be able to take classes at Bloomsburg, and at Lock Haven. So I'm gonna have to invest in a car for you to be able to travel several hundred miles between the if you're going to all three campuses to get their various classes. What does that look like? How can I as a parent actually say, you know, if my daughter is able to, she can go to a college that has all these opportunities at once, or now you're going to be traveling across, let's be perfectly candid, some rural roads to be able to get from one area to another in wintertime.
I will be in touch with her. Mansfield's a wonderful place. It's a destination.
Not suggesting
otherwise. It's a destination location. It grew its enrollments 8% this year. It's the only university in our midst that grew its enrollments anything like 8%, demonstrating that it is perceived as being a destination location. To be able to have access from that destination, people want to go there, to be able to have access from that site to a full range of opportunities that simply could not be available, not because Mansfield is bad or the people are bad, just because the enrollment base doesn't justify the extent of academic.
I'm not arguing the wonderful section of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania in the north central part of the state that is Mansfield. I'm not arguing that the campus itself isn't beautiful. And I'm not saying that the academic rigors there aren't good. What I'm saying is, if my daughter is a student at Mansfield and I'm going to tell her that she has to commute to Bloomsburg to be able to get that business degree, why would I do that? Because in effect, what we're saying in the western part of the state is Cal and the Mon Valley, it's pretty far away from Edinburgh, right? That's basically the entire north-south distance of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, or pretty close to it. Austin's not here. He would be able to correct me if I'm wrong. But if you're going from the Mon Valley in Cal and you're going up to Edinburgh in Erie County, and you're and my daughter is saying, I'm really interested in going to Cal, but half of her classes are going to be in Edinburgh, how's that going to work?
Again, that's the next part of what we deliver where and how is the next part of the planning process. I wouldn't necessarily jump to conclusions that people are driving around a lot or taking everything online.
Sure, but I understand that. But those are the questions that we understand by your own admission. We don't have answers to. But if the next phase is scheduled to be released in April, clearly people are giving this thought already. I mean, these are 14 very well managed organizations. You and your staff doing a very solid job, an incredible job of looking at all these questions. You've been strategically planning. You've thought about this, I'm sure, in your interview process when you came in here.
Yeah.
So clearly there is thought being given to what this is going to look like.
Yeah. And the students that I speak to, as I said before, are genuinely excited about the opportunities that are available to them through this process.
Sure. And I understand that. I'm certainly not questioning your communication with students. My last point, and Mr. Chairman, thank you for the time. My last point is, one of the major success stories that we've had in the Greater Lehigh Valley, you know, we've talked about this directly, has been the increased integration, and that's a buzzword. I'll say the relationships growing between our urban core students and our urban core districts and our PASSHE schools. Bloomsburg and now Kutztown have excellent agreements with the Allentown School District. 90% of my students are students of color, 90% poverty. And so that's been a very, very good thing. I think Millersville has a similar relationship with Reading School District, and I imagine that these are growing and there are instances that I simply don't know about. How in this process, let me rephrase, I'm not going to ask the question, I'm going to ask for a promise. One of the is part of the phase two that you're engaging right now has to include our ability to build and maintain those relationships with our most at-risk students, with our poorest communities, and our communities that are, quite frankly, underrepresented and not seen nearly as much in all of our colleges and universities, but for the case of today's conversation for our PASSHE schools.
Yeah.
So it needs to be, and it has to be part of those conversations, that those articulation agreements, those deals, those plans remain in place and are in fact expanded as part of this.
That's right. No, that's exactly right. And that's why I urge the Higher Education Funding Commission, as you know, to think about funding pathways and not sectors, because we build these frictionful boundaries for students that are very difficult, especially for our at-risk students to overcome. But if we think about how to fund pathways and not sectors, we may be able to help those students in ways which currently are very difficult to do.
Agreed. Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. The final question will be from Representative Schroeder, who I believe is online. Representative?
Hi. Yes, you.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Chancellor, for being here. I just had a quick question regarding, I guess, for me, when I went to Millersville, I'm a Millersville grad, very prideful, and I talked to a couple students while, you know, in the community lately, and they're concerned about class sizes. I know lecture halls, like some of our gen eds that we offer in PASSHE, like, you know, our sciences and art and different things are in a giant lecture hall, like 300 students, but things that, like, I went to school for, you know, international studies as my minor, I was able to be in a very unique, small, individual class, which was very attractive to me and why I went to Millersville for my education, that I knew I would have that one-on-one with my faculty and, you know, a smaller class size to really have that extra attention and allows for, you know, a different, unique kind of opportunity in the classroom. So is, I guess, as we're doing this and we're talking about, you know, what we're going to do to different majors and how we're going to interact with saving budgets and different things. I just want us to also be very mindful of the student experience through that and learning, because I know we had comparative Asian studies for one of our courses, and it was something that they did as a pilot program. And because I was a student and I was in my third and fourth year of the university, I was able to participate in that. So I really don't want those types of programs ever being inhibited by us, you know, cutting anything or doing anything, because it really did help me see things that I wasn't actually getting or being interacting with without doing that. So I just want to say, if we are going to go forward with changing courses that are available and different things, what's so attractive by our universities and our state system is that smaller classroom, that intimate setting where you can ask questions, do different types of projects. So just wanted to see if you have any thoughts on that too, or if you've heard that complaint from the student bodies at all from our PASSHE schools.
Yeah, no, great question. Obviously, preserving the quality and richness of experience, expanding the quality of richness of experience, expanding the range of opportunities that are available to our students, that is really what this is about. And again, I'll say what I said in my introductory remarks. If we keep our eyes focused there, then the, you know, the financial advantages will follow. So that's, I guess, thing one. Thing two is I have also heard the narrative around, you know, bloated class sizes. I don't understand it. The data don't suggest it. The changes we're looking at, you know, would on average mean the difference of a couple students per class. I mean, two, three, four. I mean, just put yourself in a class and, you know, in your mind's eye, there's 20 students, now there's 23, 24. I mean, is my experience really diminished in some way, shape, or form? There's no evidence in the research record that I'm aware of that draws a solid line. In post-secondary education, you can do this in K-12 between class size and student outcomes, best, particularly around these kinds of small marginal differences. I guess the other point I'd make is that I really appreciate this. Super helpful, especially now, because as we go into the next process, next part of the process, this generates a range of really important areas that we need to be concerned about, and I appreciate that. But I just would ask the members, and I'll be back, so now you'll have some time to think about this. We can't save everything we're doing in the current environment. Our students' needs are changing. Our employers' needs are changing. Our communities' needs are changing. The world in which we live is changing. The funding environment which we're presented with is challenging. So I'll remind us that we are here where we are today because these choices were left unaddressed. They have accumulated. They are really challenging. And we can push this train over the track at any point on any one of these issues, because we're not satisfying alumni, because we're not satisfying athletes, because we're not satisfying communities, because we're not, and any number of constituency groups are going to be impacted by this change, hopefully in a positive way. But I would urge us to think as we go through these appropriations requests about where we are and what our options are. They are very narrow. We can have all of these things. I can cost out that for you, right? But this is the challenge to me of higher education public policy. It's about identifying what we really need and must accomplish for the people of this state in some priority order, and then lining up the strategies and the funding models that support that. I will help you, but ultimately, I'm here to help you. In effect, those bigger questions are yours to answer. So I look forward to working with you, and I'm probably not a closing statement, Representative Sunny, so please continue with your questions.
Representative,
no, that was good. Thank you, Chairman. No, I was just going to say, I know this is no easy feat to accomplish, and I thank you for all the hard work that you and your staff have put into this and being involved in it. And just want to let you know that, you know, I think anytime there's communications that are happening, that's great with, you know, all stakeholders. And I really appreciate you really doing what you said and coming through on doing this and taking it right on by the horns. So
thank you,
Representative. Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Chancellor.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'd just like to remind the members that we must be done by 11, so I'm going to allow one final follow-up from Representative Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will be quick. Chancellor, again, thank you for your hard work. And as someone who represents parts of Monroe County and Pike County, East Stroudsburg University obviously is very large in my community. One question I did want to ask before is there have been a lot of questions coming towards us, both at the university and to myself as well, in regards to the connection East Stroudsburg University and Kutztown University in future conversations of an integration model. And I know. So I'm going to just put you on the spot here for a moment. Just to get your feedback on that, just so that we can throw that out there because of the questions being asked. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So look, just so you know, I'm focused on what's in the deck. We've got a lot of work on right now. This is two groups of three. All the range of issues that you've addressed so well have to be dealt with. I think that's a lot right now, and I'm not looking any further beyond that. The model that we're pursuing, if we ever need to extend it, is extensible. We'll learn something. So, you know, if we need to do this again in some way, shape, or form. But honestly, I look to tomorrow in the next couple of months, that far out, as for me, and I think of myself as a kind of future guy. That's right now just not in, at least not in my horizon.
Thank you, and I appreciate that. Thanks so much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And thank you, Chancellor Greenstein, for being here today. We know this is the beginning, and yes, you will be back in about 3 months. Act 50 requires you to report to us quarterly, I believe. So as we wrap this up this morning, and obviously you're free to give any type of closing remark you would like, but could you just give a very brief recap of what was accomplished in phase one and what you are looking to accomplish in phase two?
Yeah, sure. Thank you. So phase one was a financial review. It basically asks the question, in my words, you know, is the juice worth the squeeze? If you take these universities, you know, and we use our multi-year budget projections, you know, we have a sense of where they're likely to go if we continue as we are. We built a model which enables us to look at where they might go if we integrate them. In those ways, so that was accomplished. Through that analysis, we transitioned from looking at three groups of two to two groups of three, one each in the Northeast, one in the West. We also built an outline process that you've seen for the planning process for the next phase, which is the detailed phase where we get to throw ourselves at the very good and important questions, many of which you've asked here today. That will be refined over the next couple weeks as we launch that phase. I'm proud of what we've accomplished. I have a feeling it was the easy part. So
really, you're really looking at more at courses now in this next phase.
We're looking in great detail about what does an integrated institution look like, and how do we get there? Yeah. And all of the questions which immediately spring to people's minds. How do we, enable and support student pathways? How do we, what does it look like with respect to view of athletics? How do we manage student supports? What's taught by whom, where, and how? All of those questions. What's the local leader? What does leadership and governance look like? All of those questions get addressed.
And what is your timeline on this phase?
We hope to bring a plan back to the board for consideration at its meeting in mid-April. Plans, one for each. Group.
So our next meeting, second phase, will not be complete.
Phase, it would not be complete. It would be if it's quarterly. It would be a midpoint check-in. So, it would be a great opportunity to give an indication of where I think we're going, what we're learning, what the road bumps are, and so then we'll have another meeting at the next quarter where those plans, if we're able to keep to schedule, will be available for consideration.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And any other?
Yeah, just to follow the thought. So the overall timeline, I apologize for not giving it, you know, and this is, you know, any number of things could happen to derail this, but financial review complete in October, develop detailed implementation plans between October and April, contingent on consideration by the board. We could launch a public review and comment period that would last for 60 days from April. The earliest the board could take a decision to integrate universities would be July of 2021. The soonest an integrated university could enroll its first cohort of students would be August 2022. So this is a very long journey. We are at the very, very early stage of a very long journey.
Rest up. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think this hearing is adjourned.